Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and our friends from Kuwait, Oman, and wherever else in the world you're joining us from. Welcome to the session on the Indian Budget 2021. Almulla Exchange Kuwait and Modern Exchange Oman have for years been organizing these events in live formats in their respective countries. We have brought in experts in the field every year to share with our customers and friends the views on the budget of each year. And we consider this not just our corporate social responsibility, but we believe that it's essential because in both these countries, the largest number of expats are from India. And therefore, it makes a lot of economic sense for them to know what is happening back home and what are the economic prospects for India that come largely out of the budget proposals that are made. Almulla Exchange Kuwait and Modern Exchange Oman have become industry leaders in their respective countries and are known to be the best exchange companies in terms of service standards, in terms of quality of service, in terms of efficiency, in terms of priority. Whatever norms you apply, we consider ourselves to be right up there. And it's a simple thing that our focus is on always beating customer expectations, not just meeting them. And to that extent, we were the first exchange company in the Middle East to operationalize electronic file transfer of transactions when the demand draft was the prevalent method of transferring funds. We were one of the first to have an app and online system. And even today, our app is acknowledgedly way ahead of other apps in the industry. Most of our work management collective time is spent on making sure that we receive customer feedback and build that into our processes. Having talked a bit about our business, I would like to invite those of you who haven't experienced our services to please do join us. India as a country is home for a lot of us, and we are keen to know all the time about the progress that India is making, especially after the pandemic has destroyed a lot of conventional wisdoms in the world. One of the conventional wisdoms was that every country should have discipline in spending. So fiscal deficits, monetary deficits, budgetary deficits had to be operated within a certain limitation, because otherwise it was thought that it could result in future inflationary trends that could destroy economies. We have seen that in the last 1.5 years, the major economies in the world, US, Canada, UK, you name them, have thrown these concepts out of the window and have their finance ministers, by whatever name called, have openly said that at the moment the priority is to put food on the table for the people who have lost their jobs. To that end, they have institutionalized payouts, weekly payouts to their unemployed. That has driven their fiscal deficits through the roof. But they believe that this is the only way to prevent total destruction of their economies. We in India have just the problem of having too many people as a population size to do this, and therefore the finance minister had to choose a better way of spending the money, which was to spend it through building infrastructure. A very noble thought indeed, but as we know in India, the proof of the pudding is always in the execution, in the eating, and we don't eat very well because we don't execute very well. Therefore, we asked Dhinal Bhai, who is an acknowledged expert on the Indian budget, to come and share with us his views on the budget, his views on the proposals, his views on how these proposals, if implemented well, could result in good tidings for the Indian economy. And last but not the least, a very important aspect is that in both Kuwait and Oman, we've seen over the last year or so that there is, I wouldn't call it an exodus, but there is a marked increase in the number of people who are going back for good to India. And we have requested him to talk about how the budget proposals directed to NRIs are important, how NRIs going back home should be careful about issues that the budget proposes for them, and view India as a market where they will go back and stay. I would like to now introduce Mr. Dhinal Shah, the keynote speaker for today. Dhinal is a partner of EY's, that is Ernst & Young's Indian member firm. He's a chartered accountant and lawyer by profession, with more than 25 years of experience in advising clients on taxation, exchange control, regulatory issues, double tax treaties, private equity exposures, optimizing tax credits, due diligence, transfer pricing, foreign tax systems, corporate tax, accounting standards, you name it and he's got it. So we now request Dhinal Bhai to come and address all of us. A request to all viewers, please put in your questions in the comments section. A team of our back office staff will compile these questions and give it them to Dhinal, and Dhinal will address as many questions as he can at the end of the session. So have a good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and enjoy the session on the Indian Budget 2021, organized by Al Mulla Exchange Kuwait and Modern Exchange Oman. Thank you.
Good evening and namaste to all of you. Thank you very much to Al Mulla Exchange and Modern Exchange Oman for giving me this opportunity to share some thoughts on the Indian budget. I heard Mr. Dawar saying about the implementation challenge about the Indian economy and the Indian policies. And I would agree with him completely that the Government of India intentions on certain economic reforms are well thought out direction and a pathway till 2025. And achieving a 5 trillion economy target for the country like India is well poised. But yes, the implementation of all these policies in a real democratic country will become a challenge if it is not implemented properly. Let me take certain economics on certain Indian budget to just give you a perspective from the financial side. Because of the COVID and because of pandemic situation, India is expecting a negative growth of 7.5% with a fiscal deficit of 9.5%. Fiscal deficit in general would mean that the government would have to borrow money or to improve the money supply to meet its obligations on both the infrastructure project, the capital expenditure, and the revenue expenditure. This fiscal deficit is proposed to be reduced to 6.8% in 2022, with an expected GDP growth in 2022 of 11%. The Indian Monetary Fund also is hopeful that India will grow at 11.5% in 2022. But this growth may not be sustainable in long run. And therefore, from March 23 onwards, India is expecting to grow anything between 6.5 to 7% with a reduced GDP from 6.8% to 6%, 5%, 4%, and ultimately to achieve a target of 3% fiscal deficit. The inflation is expected at around 6%, and the bank normal rate has also been reduced substantially to 6%. Today in India, on bank fixed deposit or a debt mutual fund, the average earning is anything between 5 to 6%. The Indian economy today at a gross domestic product level is around $2.5 to $2.7 trillion, which is less than China of $13.4 trillion or an US economy of $20.5 trillion. And therefore, there is no option for India but to grow, which we all are hopeful, subject to the implementation and the political stability in the country. But the original target of 2025 to achieve a 5 trillion economy may face a challenge, and it may get delayed by the economic expectation to around 2030 or 2031. The Indian foreign exchange reserves has been one of the highest. It is as high as $584 billion with an FDI investment of $27.5 billion and the foreign portfolio investors of $28.5 billion. In both the category, the investment is 12 to 14% higher than the compared to the similar period of the last year. If I just give you an example, only on 1st February and the 2nd February, the day on which the budget was announced by the government, and the second day, the foreign portfolio investors invested in India almost $1 billion plus. Only on 2nd February, it was $837 million were invested into the stock market. And you are all aware about what the Indian stock exchange index has gone almost 50,000. The only challenge which India is facing that gradually the saving rate is on the reduction path. Around 2007, our saving rate was as high as 36 to 37%, which is gradually reducing to 30%, which I believe that with the growth of the economy, with the increase in education, with both husband and wife started working, the increase in consumption has increased, and that has impacted the reduction in the saving rate, which is now around 30% of the GDP. I was reading an article today in the Business Standard about the credit rating being downgraded by the Standard & Poor's for Kuwait. The similar thing happened for India, and the economists have challenged that credit rating because Indian credit rating was downgraded to BBB+, which raised certain concerns for the government. Government's view is that India's debt obligations are lesser than the foreign exchange reserves. And therefore, both public and private sectors, if they have to repay that debt on day one, they have sufficient foreign exchange to meet their obligation. And therefore, the credit rating, what has been rated by many foreign credit rating agencies, is actually having a bias. And that is what exactly in the news article of the Kuwait, that the finance minister of the Kuwait has also made a statement that we have sufficient money to repay our obligations. And therefore, that also shows that there are certain bias approaches on the credit rating being given to certain countries. Because the debt to GDP ratio in a country like Japan is 444% to the gross domestic product, whereas in India, it is as low as 128% of the GDP, which shows that compared to Japan, we are four times lesser in the borrowing from an economy perspective. And the Japan economy is only around $5 trillion, a double than the Indian economy, whereas the debt is almost four times than the Indian economy. And therefore, that somewhere justifies the government's and the economics argument that the credit rating given to the country like India is having a bias. Another important factor is on the corporate profits to GDP, which demonstrates that ultimately when there is an economic growth and when the goods and services are produced, ultimately does it result into profitability for a corporate. The global average is 4.7% of the GDP, whereas the Indian average is as low as 1.8 to 2%. That itself shows that the overall profitability for the corporate sector is on the lower path, because one of the other factors for India is that 60 to 70% population is still based on the agriculture activities. The overall share of the agriculture sector in the economy is anything between 13 to 15%, whereas the manufacturing and the service sector are almost equal. But I would say that because of the COVID, the service sector GDP growth has actually reduced. And in the current year, that is financial year 2021, both manufacturing and service sector are degrowing, but they are expected to grow from financial year 21-22, when once the vaccination project is over and the life becomes normal, which is expected around June 21. The other two important factors about India is on the public reforms or the policy reforms. One of the observations which is made in the economic survey document, that India is overregulated. Even if for the smallest thing, they want to regulate through rules and regulation, which is creating the hurdles for the citizens of this country, the business community of this country. And therefore, how do you reduce the compliance burden? How do you reduce the overall legal compliance so that the businesses are able to do their business and their focus on the business rather than only on the legal and the tax compliances? The other important factor about the economy is the innovations and the research. There is a global innovation index of 131 countries, and for the first time, India has entered into a less than 50. So today, the India's innovation index is around 48. We are all aware that India as a country has the highest young population. The overall competence, hard work, sincerity, and the commitment to the work is one of the highest in the Indian professionals and the Indian community. But that has to also result into certain innovation, certain research work, so that more and more patents, more and more trademarks, more and more copyrights can be filed. This trend is not a good trend for India, because overall the public sector spend on the research and innovations is much higher than the private sector. The private sector research and the innovation expenditure is as low as 3% compared to a global economies of 12 to 15%. And therefore, one of the suggestions from the government is to a private sector. And the private sector are expecting certain incentives from the government, which ultimately supports the private sector in making more and more innovations in the research-based industry. After the COVID 2019, 2020-21, Everybody talks about a V-shaped recovery, the W-shaped recovery, the U-shaped recovery. But one of the alternative way to look at is it is more about a K-shaped recovery. Because in a later K, the 70 to 75% sectors are doing very well in India today. You take pharma, you take textiles, you take constructions, you take chemicals. Every sectors are doing well. But at the same time, because of the lockdown, because of the curfews in many parts of the country, the hospitality industries, the aviation, travel and tourism, restaurants, food items, these are all having still a challenge. And therefore, those businesses will take another 3 to 6 months to come back to a normalcy of the pre-COVID situation. And therefore, I would put it that it is more about a K-shaped recovery where 70-75% businesses have come back to normalcy, but 20-25% businesses will still take some time to get back to normalcy. One of the major challenges in India is about the revenue collection. India is having a population of 137 crores, but the tax filers are as low as 6 to 7 crore people. The overall revenue collection of the GDP is as low as 10.8 to 11% of the GDP. And therefore, the government is making their efforts on investment into digital, investment into artificial intelligence, investment into machine learning, so that more and more information is captured from the economic transactions. And those people who are not in compliance of law, those people who are not filing their tax returns are forced to file their tax return to make it compulsory for them. And therefore, I would put it that the government is making the highest investment into the technology. And because of the technology, the laws like income tax, the laws like GST, the laws like customs, everything is trying to be aligned and match so that people do not play with different laws in different manner. And therefore, there is a higher compliance. If there is a higher compliance, ultimately, it will improve the revenue collection of the government. In December 2020 and January 2021, the GST collection was as high as 1.15 lakh crores, which also shows that the Indian economy is growing at a much faster rate than what was happening during 6 months back because of the slowdown of economic activity and even the challenges because of the pandemic situation. Because Indian economy rate GDP in March 2020 was also as low as 4.5% compared to 6.5% in 2019. And therefore, compared to 1920, the negative minus 7.5% growth in 2021 with only 6 months of working is a much better growth. And therefore, overall, the economy is doing reasonably well. Let me come back to certain policy decisions which are made by the government in a part of a budget document. The first policy decision is about the banking sector. Government wants to privatize two banks, which are public sector, and one insurance company. As you are aware, that Government of India nationalized all banks as public sector banks in 1969. So it is almost after 51 years that government has now decided to privatize two banks. And there is a disinvestment and privatization policy which has been cleared by the Government of India, which says that government would like to continue to be in the business only for certain strategy sector which are required from the country's security perspective and from the country's perspective. Otherwise, they would prefer that let the private sector run the business and government only do overall monitoring rather than doing the regulations of each and every actions of the government. And therefore, the private sector are more free to carry on their business what they like in the best economic interest. The other important proposal is that because of the COVID, the stress asset and the non-performing assets have increased reasonably high. And therefore, the intention is that the stress asset and non-performing assets can be moved to a separate company called Asset Reconstruction Company, so that there is a larger focus on recovery. There is a larger focus with a transparent process on highest recovery. And the public sector bank can continue to focus more on the credit growth rather than only focusing on the recovery of the bad loans. And that is a good objective. But if again, if there is a transparent process and if the recoveries are made on a faster basis, then the present value of money would be much higher, which could be reinvested into the new credit of tech. For the first time, the expenditure on the health and well-being has been increased substantially. It was 86,000 crore in 1920, which has been increased to 223,000 crore in 2021, which also includes around 35,000 crore expenditure on the vaccination project, and which is almost more than the double expenditure is expected by the government on health and well-being. Similarly, on the capital expenditure, which ultimately will create economic growth, which ultimately will create employment generation, was 4.39 lakh crore in 2021, which is expected and planned at almost 5.54 lakh crore in 21-22, and an incremental 2 lakh crore for the capital expenditure in the states and the union undertaking. So this is one of the very good intention and very good planning which the government is making, so that when the fiscal deficit is increasing and the borrowing monies are used for the capital expenditure, then at least there is a creation of an asset which ultimately contributes to the economic growth. And along with economic growth, there will be an employment generation. During COVID, the government also announced for almost 13 sectors like pharma, textiles, chemicals, engineering, what is called a profit-linked incentives. So when you set up a new business and there are defined products and defined industries which are there in the government regulations, and if you make an investment into that and whatever profit you earn from the new businesses, the government will actually give you a cash refund from 5 to 20% in next 5 years. So the expected amount of such refund, which is called profit-linked incentive, it will be as high as 1.97 lakh crore in next 5 years. And this is very good support from the government for the investment in a new manufacturing sector, which government, based on the profits made, will actually refund from 5 to 20%. One of the concerns for an Indian economy is the investment into infrastructure. In last 7 to 8 years, the new government, which came into force in 2014, there is a substantial focus on infrastructure. This year budget also, there is an investment in infrastructure by almost 1,18,000 crores. And there is also a proposal that government would set up what is called development financial institution, which will fund both private and public sector in the infrastructure. And if there is an infrastructure which will ultimately generate the employment and will also contribute to the economic growth of the country. The other proposal is about merging the securities financial codes. You would be aware that government, in a monsoon session of the parliament in September 2020, merged 29 labor codes or labor-related laws almost into 4 codes, what is called labor codes. All these labor codes are likely to be implemented from 1st April 2021. The intention of the government was that all old laws, which has outdated, plus there are non-alignment of provisions between different laws, and therefore industry was facing substantial difficulty in implementing and compliance. So to reduce all these, all 29 laws were merged into 4 laws. Similarly, before 4 years, the Insolvency Bankruptcy Code was formed, which also merged 3 to 4 laws related to recovery of the stress asset. Now there is a proposal that the Security Exchange Board of India, which is SEBI, which regulates the listed entities, or the Security Contract Regulation Act, the Government Securities Act, and the Depositories Act, all will be merged into 1 code, what is called Security Financials Code. There are also amendments proposed into Limited Liability Partnership Act. When the law was enacted in 2008, there were a number of provisions in the law by which if you do not comply, it would attract a criminal implications. And therefore, businesses were very worried about those compliances. So the government realized this, and the LLP Act will be amended so that all such criminal activities which are having an implication make the law on a decriminal basis. Similar amendments were made in the Companies Act before 2 months, and number of provisions have been removed from the Companies Act to make it decriminalize the Companies Act. There is a definition of small company under the Companies Act, that small company was having a certain limits up to which they were having called small company. Those limits are substantially increased from a capital of 50 lakhs to 2 crores and from a turnover of 2 crore to 20 crore. The small companies have substantial relaxations under the Companies Act from compliances, including the financial reporting, including compliance to accounting standards, and certain compliances with Register of Companies. And therefore, if you are having a smaller businesses but you want to carry on the business in a company, you would have certain relaxation from the compliances. Similarly, there is a concept called one-person company. It is mainly meant from the technocrats. I'm sorry for some technology glitch. Let me go back to on a vehicle scrapping policy. So the India announced a vehicle scrapping policy that all private vehicles after 20 years and commercial vehicles after 15 years will have a fitness test. And if they clear the fitness test, then only they would be allowed to run on the roads, subject to payment of certain green fees. Otherwise, these vehicles will have to be discarded. The intention is to reduce the pollution, increase the petrol and diesel efficiency, and also boost the auto sector. Interestingly, on 27 January 21, the Kuwait government also announced that all commercial vehicles should be scrapped by 20. The other important factor on the part of the budget policy is on the privatization and monetization. You are aware that the Life Insurance Corporation of India is one of the biggest life insurance of the country, which is going to be made a listed entity on the Indian Stock Exchange, up to 10% of dilution. Similarly, companies like Air India, companies like the BPCL, that is Bharat Petroleum Corporation, and similar other companies, the government is planning to privatize and monetize the money. They are also planning that certain surplus assets and certain assets which are not of a productive use and which are lying idle can also be monetized by the government so that the effective and the economic use can be made of those assets by the government. The only challenge in this entire budget is about unemployment. There is not a single statement in the entire budget about how do you improve the employment generation of the people. Particularly during COVID situation, number of people were laid off. Number of people lost their job, and they were all finding difficult even to repay their installment for their personal assets and car. Even the government employment expectation is not more than 3%. The government employment is today 3.1 million, which is expected to increase to 3.4 million. And therefore, unless there is a real implementation of the capital expenditure, real implementation of the infrastructure project, and certain other sectors where there is a necessity for the government to intervene and the employment is not generated, then the employment generation will become a challenge for the country, particularly when the youngsters are there and they are all educated and they are in search of a good job for the purpose of their professional career. The other challenge which is getting created is the use of a technology. With the increase in use of a technology, both by the government and the private sector, the employment also becomes a challenge. And therefore, the government will have to make a substantial real hard efforts so that the economic growth is spurred and the employment generation is created. Let me come to certain important tax proposals which would interest you from the Kuwait and Oman perspective. As far as the rate of taxation is concerned, there is no change in the rate of taxation. Today, the highest rate of taxation for a company is 25.17, including surcharge and education fees. But if you put up a new manufacturing plant, which starts operation before 31st March 2023, then the rate of tax is as low as 17%. And that 17% will be permanent rate of taxation for the new manufacturing sector, including the future expansions in that business. So today, if you invest only 50 crore, but in another 5 years, you invest another 200 crore, then that company will continue to get a benefit of 17% rate of taxation for that manufacturing sector. Similarly, for an individual, the average rate of taxation is around 25 to 28% for the larger class of the people, except a super rich or a high net worth, where the rate of taxation, if the income is above 5 crore, then the rate of taxation is as high as 43%. But in this budget, there has not been a tinkering with the rate of taxation with an intention to bring consistency in the tax rates. However, there is one maybe a bona fide error which has crept into, but which affects all of you, is that the surcharge on the tax deduction at source, which is withholding tax, and the surcharge on the advance tax for the non-resident Indians, there is a difference in both, which I believe that ultimately government, while passing the budget, will correct that mistake. But that seems to be one of the mistakes which has left out in leaving the surcharge on the withholding tax and leaving a surcharge on the advance tax liability for the non-residents. One important change which is proposed is on the depreciation on goodwill. You are aware that whenever you acquire a business, you would always pay some premium for that particular business. And that premium would consist of a brand, trademark, network, or any other intangible assets. In India, the depreciation was eligible on intangibles, but there were different judicial view about whether a depreciation is eligible on goodwill or not. Now meant from financial year 2021 has now proposed to be provided that the goodwill will not be treated as an intangible asset and that will not be eligible for depreciation. And this impact is going to come from financial year 2021. So technically, it is almost like a retrospective effect. Similarly, there was certain interpretation from a judicial authorities on what is called a slump sale. Slump sale means you sell a business as a going concern to a third party or to a related party as a business rather than what is called merger or demerger. So in a slump sale, there were many plannings which are being made from a tax efficiency perspective, what is called slump sale against an exchange of securities. Now, there were certain technical interpretation made by the judiciary. Now, to overcome that interpretation, to overcome certain judicial view, the law has been proposed to be amended from financial year 2021 so that such tax planning is not encouraged. And as and when there is a slump sale, then the taxpayer would have to pay the tax as per the prescribed provisions under the Income Tax Act. Similarly, in case of a partnership firm, again, there were certain tax planning which were being made, where like that when if there are partners and if one of the partner retires and if the asset is distributed to that partner, then again, there were certain tax planning which the people were making. So to overcome that, even the distribution of an asset on retirement of a partner will now be subject to a capital gain tax liability in the hands of the firm. Similarly, if there is a capital of 100 rupees, but if the higher capital is repaid by the firm on retirement of a partner, then that incremental amount of capital because of the valuation of an asset or valuation of a business would also be subject to a capital gain tax liability in the hands of the partnership firm. There were many people which were making investment in the insurance linked product. So there were, it was an investment plus insurance, which is called unit link insurance plan. Now, what is being proposed is that if you make a prepayment of premium of 2,50,000 plus per policy, which is an investment link insurance product, then on maturity, the amount will not be subject to amount will be subject to taxation. Today, there was a provision in law which would provide that such redemption may not be taxable if certain principles and conditions are maintained. So from now onwards, from 1st April 2021 onwards, if the premium is more than 2,50,000 Indian rupees, and if it is an insurance linked investment product, then on maturity it will be treated as an equalization, like an equity mutual fund. Then it will be subject to security transaction tax, and it will be taxed at 10%, similar to any other mutual fund. There are substantial amendments which are proposed in the GIFT City, which is International Financial Services Center. I am from Ahmedabad, and the GIFT City is also located in Gujarat between Ahmedabad and Gandhinagar. It is the first of its kind as International Financial Services Center, which is called a Financial Special Economic Zone. Now, there are substantial benefits which are given to make the financial activities located from the GIFT City. This time, if you are engaged in the business of leasing of an aircraft or aircraft engine, then also the benefits have been extended if you do an activity from the International Financial Services Center. Similarly, there are many offshore banking funds and offshore funds which are located in many countries. If those offshore funds get relocated to the International Financial Services Center, then the entire relocation plus the subsequent income also would be subject to nil taxation. And therefore, number of benefits and the incentives have been given for doing a business from International Financial Services Center. Last year, the government introduced a provision where the sovereign wealth from Abu Dhabi, from Middle East, and from any other countries which were making investment into infrastructure debt fund, they were given an exemption subject to an approval from the government. And one of the sovereign wealth fund has already been granted an approval. But there were certain implementation issues by such fund. There were certain conditions which were required to be met, which got relaxed. And there are certain other relaxation which has been given to all the sovereign wealth fund for making an investment into the infrastructure sector in India. Many Indians who are working overseas, but after retirement, they migrate to India. Now, when they migrate to India, that social security contributions which are made in the overseas country continue to be earn income outside India. But once they become Indian resident, they will have to pay tax on the global income. And therefore, certain disparity was there between the taxation of such social security contributions in the overseas country and their income tax liability in India. So now a proposal has been made that all these there will be a rules which will be given by the government, which will streamline the taxability of such withdrawal from social security in the overseas country once those non-residents gets migrated to India. One of the other far-reaching amendment which has been proposed is that today, when any Indian resident makes an investment into the provident fund, either a recognized provident fund or a public provident fund, then the contribution and the interest earned thereon is completely tax-free, either on maturity or on withdrawal. Now, what is proposed is that if you make a contribution as an employee more than 2,50,000 rupees, then interest on the incremental amount of contribution, as and when it is matured, it will be subject to taxation. So today, the exemption which was granted to entire interest is now partially withdrawn, and all interest on the incremental amount of 2,50,000 could become taxable as and when it is there. There were a number of questions which I got from Mr. Dawar's team, and which is on the senior citizen related provisions. So let me explain you in detail. What is being proposed is that if a person is a senior citizen, and senior citizen means 75 years plus, and if I have only pension income and the interest income from the bank fixed deposit or from the saving bank deposit or from any other deposits with the same bank, then my tax liability will be calculated by the bank, my liability will be discharged by the bank, and in that case, the senior citizen will not be required to file any tax return. Now, this provision is applicable only if I have a pension income and if I have an interest income from that bank. The government is going to notify certain banks, say, for example, State Bank of India could be notified. And then if a person is more than 75 years of age, then he can give his particulars of interest income and the pension income to the bank. And then the bank will calculate the tax liability. Bank will discharge the tax liability to the government. There is no change in the slab rate. So today, if I am age between 60 to 80 years, my basic exemption limit is 3 lakhs. But if I'm more than 80 years, my basic exemption limit is 5 lakhs of rupees. That has not changed. The only thing what has changed is that my obligation to file tax return is removed, and my liability to tax on the pension income, the interest income, would be discharged by the bank. And therefore, if I have the dividend income or I have any other long-term capital gain, then I would not be entitled to take the benefit of this particular section. I will have to calculate my tax liability. I will have to file my tax return on my own. The incidental question is that if my income is below taxable limit, can I submit a form to the bank that the bank should not do any TDS? So today, what is the provision under the law is that if I am a senior citizen for which the senior citizen age is 60 years and above. So if I am a 60 years and above, and if I have an interest income, if I have a dividend income, then I can give a form called 15G, G capital, to the bank, to the company, that I am not expecting my income to be above 3 lakhs, and therefore, please do not do any withholding of tax on my income. And once I file that form, the bank or the company will not do any withholding of tax as far as those amounts are concerned. But if my income is likely to be more than the exemption limit, in that case, I will not be able to give that form number 15G because my income is taxable, and therefore, the bank or the company will have to do a withholding tax, and I will have to file my tax return. If I have interest income, capital gain, pension income, dividend income, or any other income as a person is concerned. The other far-reaching change which is proposed is that last year budget introduced a provision where if the seller's turnover is more than 10 crore in the last year, and if my transaction value is more than 50 lakhs with the buyer, then the seller has to collect what is called tax collected at source called TCS at person. The similar provision has been now introduced to say that if I'm doing a business and if I buy goods, then I will also have to do a TDS at 0.1%. Now, between the TDS and TCS, the law provides that TDS will have a first priority. Only if you do not do a TDS because you do not comply the conditions of the TDS, then only you do the TCS. So, in other words, until now, the withholding tax provisions were applicable only on the services. Now it is extended even to the purchase of goods of 0.1% on the amount of purchases. And therefore, there will be a substantial compliances which would be required by the companies as far as the TDS provisions are concerned. Let me take one or two administrative related which you would have heard in the news media. Today, once my income tax return is filed, there will be an assessment, what is called a scrutiny assessment. Subsequent to the scrutiny assessment, can my cases be reopened again? Today, the limits is 6 years after the end of the assessment order for which the order was passed. That limit is proposed to be reduced to 3 years. But if Subsequently, the government comes to know about certain information for which there is a likely impact of more than 50 lakhs rupees in 1 year, which is called escapement of income. In that case, the government can reopen up to 10 years. So if escapement of income is beyond 50 lakhs rupees, then the assessment period is increased to 10 years. But if the escapement of income is less than 50 lakhs, then the reopening period would be reduced from 6 years to 3 years. Let me go to one of the important amendments which has been made from a non-resident perspective. You would be aware that in the last budget, there was a substantial amendment of the residential status of a company. And then there was a hue and cry that whether are people staying in Kuwait, people staying in Oman, would also be taxable in India if they continue to hold citizenship of India. So what was the last year law? The law was amended to say that if a person is a citizen of India, but if he does not pay tax in the other country, say for example in Kuwait or Oman, because Kuwait or Oman do not levy tax on the individual residents, in that case, that citizen will be deemed to be a resident of India. Now in India, for the residential status, let me summarize what are the provisions for a residential status. So if I am an Indian person, if I stay in India during the financial year, which is April to March, for more than 183 days, I become resident of India. But the same person, I may not stay in more than 183 days, but I stay in India only for 60 days and more. But during last 4 years, I am in India for more than 365 days. So if either I comply 183 days condition or I comply last 4 years of 365 plus current year of 60 days condition, in both the cases, I would be treated as a resident. Now, there is further category of a resident, what is called resident but not ordinary resident. What is resident but not ordinary resident? The person who is non-resident for 9 years after last 10 years, or in last 7 years, I was outside India for more than 730 days. So in other words, I am in India for less than 729 days. In that case, I would be treated as a resident, but not ordinary. Now, this distinction is very important because what was amended last year was that if I'm a citizen of India and if I do not pay tax in outside India, because there is no liability to tax in India, and my income in India is more than 15 lakhs, then I would be deemed to be resident in India. But the same person, if I do not meet the stay criteria, what I just explained a minute back, then I would be treated as resident but not ordinary resident. Now, what is the distinction between resident and ordinary resident and resident but not ordinary resident? As far as resident and ordinary resident is concerned, my global income is taxable. So whether I earn from Kuwait or whether I earn from Oman or whether I earn from USA or whether I earn from India, I am subject to taxation in India on the global taxation. And if I pay tax outside India, then as per the tax treaty between India, Kuwait and India, Oman, I would be given a tax credit as far as India is concerned. But if I'm a resident but not ordinary resident, then I would be taxable only for the Indian income. I would not be subject to taxation of the overseas income unless I carry on the business which is controlled from India. So majority of you, when you must be holding a citizenship of India, but if you are staying outside India and your income, irrespective of 15 lakhs plus or minus, you will continue to be a resident but not ordinary resident, and therefore you will continue to pay tax in India only on the Indian income, unless you is very, very critical from determination of a residential status. Now, in this connection, there was When the amendment was made, one of the terminology was used called liable to tax. Now, what is liable to tax was not defined in the Income Tax Act, which is now proposed to be defined through a budget of 21. That I should have a liability to pay tax, I should be subjected to tax in an overseas country, but it may so happen that because of certain incentives, certain exemptions, I actually may not pay the tax. But this principle may not be relevant from a Kuwait perspective, but it may be relevant from an Oman perspective. But because under India-Kuwait tax treaty, if I am a resident of Kuwait for more than 183 days, then I become a resident of Kuwait. And therefore, it has to do with a physical stay and not to do with domicile, citizenship, economic interest, personal effect, etc. Whereas in Oman, it is all in relation to your economic interest or personal effects or domicile. And therefore, the liability to tax principle may become applicable to the people staying in Oman. But as I told you, if you are staying outside India and you do not meet the physical stay criteria, you would be treated as a resident but not ordinary resident. And in that case, you would be required to pay tax in India only on the Indian income. You would not be required to pay tax of the overseas income. From a filing of a tax return perspective, every resident but ordinary resident or every resident but not ordinary resident, if they have a taxable income in India, then they have to file that tax return. In addition to that, if I'm a resident but ordinary resident, then I have to also disclose my foreign assets, including my beneficial interest in any property or asset outside India, including a particulars of the bank account where I am a signatory. But if you are a resident but not ordinary resident, then you are not required to disclose your foreign assets or a beneficial interest in foreign trust or foreign businesses or even a foreign bank accounts. And to that extent, there is no obligation for you to disclose all this in the income tax return if you continue to be resident but not ordinary resident. From a taxation perspective, the long-term capital gain, which is the shares held for more than 12 months in case of a listed assets and for unlisted assets more than 24 months, would normally be taxable at 10%. The short-term capital gain, if it is a listed assets, listed shares, then it is 15%. If it is unlisted shares, then it would be taxable at your normal income tax slab, which is 5%, 10%, 20%, and 30%, depending upon the slab in which you would fall. As far as interest income is concerned, if it is invested out of your foreign exchange money, then the interest income, which is called investment income, or the dividend income, would normally be taxable at 20%. You are aware that last year, so up to 31st March 2020, in India, when the company declares a dividend, the company was required to pay what is called dividend distribution tax. So if a company declares a dividend of 100 rupees, then company would pay 20% dividend distribution tax and will give a check of 80 rupees to the shareholder. And that 80 was not taxable in the hands of the non-resident in India, but it would get taxable in the overseas country as per the local laws. From 1st April 2020, that law was amended, and now the company will do withholding of tax. And after doing a withholding, the non-resident will have to pay tax in India if it is taxable in India or in the overseas country. Now, as per India-Kuwait treaty or as per India-Oman treaty, the dividend is taxable at 10% as per the tax treaty. However, the domestic tax provides that for a non-resident, the withholding tax would be at 20%. Now, law provides that if a withholding tax is made as per treaty, then you will have to file the tax return. But if the withholding tax is made as per the domestic tax, which is 20%, in that case, you will have to file the tax return and get the refund. For taking the treaty benefit, that is a condition of tax residency certificate, which you need to obtain from a Kuwait or Oman government and furnish to the company which is declaring the dividend or to the bank which is paying the interest on the non-resident. There is a definition of non-resident even under FEMA. Now, the Foreign Exchange Management Act has a slightly different principle from a definition of a non-resident is concerned. Under Income Tax Act, as I told you, it governs by the financial year physical stay. So for the financial year 2021, if I'm in India for more than 183 days, I could be treated as a resident and the other condition of 365 days. As far as FEMA is concerned, I have to look at my physical stay during last year. So if during 1920 I was in India for more than 183 days, then I become a resident in India from a Foreign Exchange Management Act perspective. Or if I come to India for an employment, or if I come to India for carrying on the business activity, then I become resident from day one. And therefore, the definition of a resident and non-resident between FEMA and income tax is slightly different, and one will have to take care as and when the Foreign Exchange Act is applied and the Income Tax Act is applied from a foreign exchange perspective. All non-residents under the Foreign Exchange Management Act are allowed to make an investment in India in different securities. One option is to invest into a listed stock exchange. So shares of a stock exchange, all of you can make an investment in Indian stock exchange. The limits are 5% of the paid up capital of the company in which you are making an investment, unless the limit is increased up to 24% by the company. The only condition is that when you make an investment, the money has to be routed through your foreign exchange account or the non-resident external account to make the investment on a repatriable basis so that you can take the amount of capital and the profit back to your respective country, subject to payment of taxes, which is 10% if you are holding for more than 12 months. And the other condition is that you will have to designate one bank as far as your trading transactions are concerned. The only additional care you need to take is that if you are doing a day-to-day trading in the shares and securities in India, unlike you are a long-term investor, then in case of a trading, you will also be subject to a requirement of a tax audit because you are carrying on the business of dealing in shares. And therefore, you will have to also get your accounts audited if your turnover is more than 10 crore Indian rupees as per the proposed limit under the budget. Last year, it was 5 crore, which has now been increased to 10 crore. Normally, in shares and securities, the 10 crore is a very small amount. And therefore, if you are carrying on the business activity, then you will have to also get your accounts audited, file the tax return, and comply the Indian law. In that case, you will not be subject to a 10% long-term capital gain. You will be subject to a normal tax as what a normal individual would pay as based on the slab basis. The second category of investment is called foreign direct investment. So in all unlisted companies, you can make an investment today except 7 to 8 sectors. All the sectors are under the automatic approval route and you don't need any Government of India approval for making an investment, what is called foreign direct investment scheme. In addition to that, the non-resident Indians and the overseas citizen, which is basically holding a PIO card, can also invest into mutual fund, can also invest into government dated securities, can invest into a debt mutual fund, can invest into a debt securities of the government or the public sector banks, or even the non-resident Indians can make an investment into national pension scheme. But these are all on repatriable basis. If you are interested to make an investment into a non-repatriation, then you can also invest into money market mutual fund and a national pension scheme, both by the non-resident Indian and the overseas corporate citizen. Once you make an investment, majority of the cases, the transfer of shares or securities or transfer of assets from non-resident Indian to another non-resident Indian or to a person resident in India is normally under the approval route, except you have to meet certain conditions and criteria. The only exception in this is that if a person resident outside India, who is basically not a non-resident Indian, then in that case, if he gives a gift of shares, then in that gift of shares, beyond a particular amount, you need Reserve Bank of India approval. Subject to that, one or two exceptions, majority of the conditions, the transfer of shares either by way of a sale or by way of gift is under the automatic route. In case of a sale, you also need to comply with the pricing guidelines, which has to be basically at a fair market value, and comply certain requirement on filing certain forms with the Reserve Bank of India or the banks, which is called an authorized dealer. So to that an extent, reasonably, there is a automatic approval which is given on the majority of the sector to all the non-resident Indians. Now, let me take some questions and let me start with certain questions. I have already dealt with one or two questions of 75 years of the age and Section 194 capital P, which has been introduced. One question was that I have a TRC in the last year, but I do not have a TRC in the current year because it will be issued in the current year. Can I still go into the bank and say that I was holding a TRC and I will give you a TRC? Which in my opinion, answer is yes. If you are able to give a TRC of the last year and you have been a non-resident, then you can give that evidence. And before March 21, you can give a fresh tax residency certificate and bank would normally consider and do the TDS as per the tax treaty, which is 10% under India-Kuwait treaty or India-Oman treaty as far as the interest income is concerned. So that would normally be acceptable by the bank, and normally the bank would not mind in accepting a last year TRC. One of the questions was that how NRI can make into international stock. I understand that I have already replied in my speech that you can invest into a listed securities, you can invest into unlisted securities and other securities on that. The other question is that what are the implications for the NRI who is stuck due to lockdown, as it will affect the residency number of days he stays in India, which is a very valid question and a genuine concern. So the government relaxed this condition during last year, that is in 2020, after the lockdown made in India from 21st of March 2020. So those 9 days have been excluded from the residency criteria. As far as current year is concerned, the government has yet not come out with any guidelines or criteria from the relaxation. There are representations which are being made, and I believe that the first lockdown was open in India on 18th May 2020. So at least from 1st April to 18th May and the subsequent month where there was no facility to travel outside India because of non-availability of the airlines or non-availability or there are restrictions, I will believe that government would grant relaxation, but that clarification is yet pending from the government. What is likely to happen to rupee and should NRI hold or send now? I would believe that today Indian rupee is not a fully convertible currency, whereas majority of the dollar, yen, the pound or the euro is all a fully convertible. If the Indian rupee also becomes convertible, I would believe that it would have some depreciation in the rupee, but government is trying to control the foreign exchange fluctuation between 70 to 80 rupees. There were some hints which were before few months that it may cross 80 rupees, but if the full account convertibility is taken, then it may impact the foreign exchange rate from 73 to some other number. Is shopping for gold likely to turn more expensive? In all fairness, it will be difficult for me to answer, but there is certain relaxation in the customs duty on the gold and silver. And therefore, in last 5 days, the prices of gold and silver have actually reduced in India. What would be the exchange rate predicted in 21-22? In all fairness, it will be difficult for me to say, but unless the full account convertibility is not made, the Reserve Bank of India would try to not to cross 80 rupees. So it would range anything between 70 to 80 rupees. How ULIPs are going to affect? Will ULIPs purchase existing policy will attract if exceed 2.5 lakhs? The answer is no. It is not a retrospective amendment. It is all ULIPs premium paid on or after 1st April 2021 of more than 2.5 lakhs. Only those ULIP will only get affected, not the past ULIPs. Interest rate or rule for NRA service account we take back. Is it not clear take? No, what I said was that if I was working in Kuwait or Oman for, say, for example, for 25 years, and after retirement, I migrate to India, I become a resident of India. But when I was working in Kuwait or Oman, I had certain social security contributions. Like in India, you have a provident fund. And in Kuwait and Oman, I would have made certain contributions. Now, many countries do taxation only on the maturity or retirement and not on an accrual basis. In that case, there is a mismatch between the taxability of a particular amount on a cash or accrual basis. So to overcome that, the new rules have been framed that as and when you get the social security from a respective country, in that case, only you will be subject to taxation in India, and for which the rules will be notified by the government. I thought 15H is for senior citizens and 15G is for others. The only difference is 15G is for senior citizen and 15H for others. It is exactly the opposite. What government should do to make par our education with the Western education, European and American degree is always weighing more. I agree. The government has introduced a new education policy before 6 months, and it is more made on the practical usage of the education rather than a theoretical education. And again, the government is investing into an online education. Government itself has certain online education links which provides an education. The only question is that ultimately the overall people and the quality of education, the teachers, the professors, everybody will have to make efforts so that the overall quality of education is improved. I would like to take this opportunity to ask C.A. Shah, after returning back to India forever, how long I can maintain an NRE account and what will be the best option to invest after return. Once you return to India permanently, you can't continue an NRE account because you become a resident in India for the FEMA purpose. And once you become a resident for FEMA purpose, your NRE account has to be closed and the amount has to be transferred to a resident saving account. The amount of the opportunities for investment, it is more of an asset allocation. You can invest between the shares, the mutual funds, the bank deposits, the real estate and gold. And depending upon the appetite for the risk, you can allocate your money into different asset class. I would like to take this. Okay. How many years a person can be an NOR? Normally the resident but not already resident will only be for 2 years. Because as I told you, I should be a non-resident for 9 years out of 10 years. So the year in which I come plus the next year, I will continue to be a resident but not already resident. From the 3rd year onwards, I would become a resident, an ordinary resident, and therefore I will have to pay tax on my global income. Taxation for NRA deposits. Also wanted to know, once we go back to India, how long my NRA status is valid and what about the tax structure? As I told you, once you come back to India for a permanent purpose, your NRE account has to be closed, except that if you are already holding deposits under NRE or the FCNR account, it can continue up to maturity. But once these maturities is over, to that an extent, you can claim a tax exemption from the interest income taxability. But otherwise, post-retirement, and I'm sorry, the post-migration to India and a post your leaving the residential status, you become a resident in India under FEMA purpose, you will have to offer your interest income or any other income for taxation on the global taxation basis. How the Resident Act will be applied for the people who got stuck in India due to COVID pandemic? I think I have already replied that in last year, there was a relaxation in 2020. For 21, the government is yet to give a relaxation from the physical day perspective as far as the residential criteria is concerned. As far as the OPC is concerned, the only amendment is that the non-residents will be allowed to form an OPC. At present, the condition was that I have to be in India for minimum 182 days. That limit has been reduced to 120 days. And therefore, the non-resident staying in India for 120 days can also form a one-person company. And there are substantial relaxations. After a certain period of time, you can convert OPC into a public company or a private company or a small company, depending upon your requirement. To my understanding, I have completed my speech. As I understand, I still have 2 to 3 minutes more. And if any questions are there, I will be happy to answer. I would thank to Al Mulla Exchange and the Modern Exchange Oman both and Mr. Dawar personally and his team for giving this opportunity to share my thoughts. I just got a message from Mr. Dawar's team. Let me reply. If I have pension income and I have an interest income from bank, then only the new provision of non-filing of a tax return will apply. If I have a dividend income, I have a capital gain, that this provision will not apply. But suppose if I only have a pension income, I have an interest income from a particular bank, and if I'm aged 75 years plus, then I will have to pay tax as per the normal slabs. For a 75 year, the slab is up to 3 lakhs. There is no income tax. From 3 lakhs to 5 lakhs, it is 5%. From 5 lakhs to 10 lakhs, it is 20%. And on 10 lakhs and above, it is 30%. I will have to pay tax as per that slabs. The only relaxation is that I will not have to file the income tax return. And the bank will do my TDS liability and the pay the tax on my behalf. That's the only relaxation. There is no relaxation from income tax liability. The other question, let me again repeat. If you are already holding a tax residence certificate for the last year, if you do not have a tax residence certificate for the current year, you can furnish that certificate to the bank of the last year and convince the bank that before the end of the year, you will again furnish the certificate. And in that case, bank will do the withholding tax as per the treaty rate, and bank would take this TRC as a valid document as far as the withholding of tax is concerned. Thank you very much to all of you. Namaste. Jai Hind.